church. And happy Mother's Day to all the mothers and the prospective mothers. Oh, wow, these young people are going. You know, you are talking about generational faith. And that's the way you people were not too long ago. And they're going to, like they talked about Lois, the grandmother, Eunice, the mother, and Timothy, the next generation. They'll be the Timothys of their generation in Jesus' name. Please, let's sit down. I want to thank, Pastor Dupa is not here, but I'll thank him in absentia and all the leadership of the church. Thank you very much for inviting us here. I'm glad to have Dr. Okeonuzo, my personal concordance with me this morning. We're very happy to be with you once again. Shall we pray? Our Heavenly Father, we just worship you. We thank you because you are enough, more than enough. Challenges all around, but you are more than enough. Thank you that we are loved more than we can ever imagine. So we do not need to fear or stress because we have you as our Heavenly Father. And this morning we come to you to speak your word to us. Speak to each one of us personally. Not just the mothers alone, but the fathers and the mothers and fathers to be. Speak a word that will impact our lives. And may we go out transformed to be the light of our world. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Good morning. You're all looking splendid this morning. Now, this morning, our topic is legacy of love. And what is a legacy? If you wanted long sermon, and you would have called Dr. Okeonuzo, but if you have me, just be prepared to interact. I need a live microphone for the audience. I hope there's one. Good. Because Yorubas say that omotoni ye onisun. So you people that called me, you two, you will not sleep. Oh, we're in it together. Mm-hmm. What is a legacy? Well, let me answer that so we can move. Is there a clock? Okay, right there. Legacy is an inheritance, but it comes after the owner. Talk with confidence now. After the owner dies. You people are young, but maybe some of you remember Bobby Benson's house on Ikorodu Road. That was supposed to be a legacy for his children. What happened? For some reason, after he died, the place was dilapidated. It became a den of thieves. Everybody had it. I think in the end, Lagos State took it over. If I cannot even, you don't know where it was anymore. That legacy was erased. But we have a legacy that is eternal because our legacy comes from God Almighty. God created this world as we see it. He created it and he said, it is good. Everything was good. Everything was excellent. But Adam and Eve rebelled against him. And instead of good, evil now prevailed amongst the world of men. And this happened for thousands of years, but God had a remedy. He sent his son, the light of the world. He came to the earth, died for us, so that we can have a legacy. We can inherit his light. And because he did not stay dead, I mean, Bobby Benson is in his grave now, but our Jesus did not stay dead. He rose again. And he sent us his spirit so that we, who were once darkness, can now become the light of our world. That is our legacy. But there's a problem. When we become Christians, we receive the light of God. Every one of us, each one of us. But for some reason, Some people's light shine brighter than others. True or false? True. Some people shine so bright. And some people are just, you know, little dots of light. Why? Why? Do we have physicists? You don't even need physicists. Anybody who studied physics at school set level, you know about conduction. You know about resistance. So the purer the metal is, the better the conduction. But when there are impurities, where there's sin, then the conduction is not there. So we're connected to this bright light, each one of us. But if we have impurities in our lives, the conduction will not be as it should be. And so the light in our lives is not as bright as it should be. But when you get rid of the impurity, what happens? The light will shine brighter once again. So, in each life, you have flesh competing with the Spirit of God that is deposited in your life when you give your life to Christ. The question is, who do we yield more to? Do we yield more to the Spirit or do we yield more to flesh? That will determine how much brightness of the living God we let come out of our lives. Now, we're talking this morning about generational faith. You have sent the children away, but we have the verse, 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5. It makes reference to Timothy. It says, I have been reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded now lives in you also. Now, I can see all of you. I've met and interacted with many of you. There are some people here who are real or more four square. You have, your mother was here, maybe your grandmother was also here. They brought you when you were, you know, from when you were a child. And I'm sure you remember the songs. These children are probably too touche. They don't sing those songs. Oh, whoa, Jesu. Talong pariwo. Do your children know these songs? Ah, praise God. We have gone beyond that. Yes, I know. I've been seeing them. We have Peter. Where are you? Those are the Dingiri Four Square people. Mm-hmm. Ayobola, the Charleses. There are more of you. You know yourselves, Abby. Yes, so. Yes, so. We thank God. But you see, some of us, you know, you have an advantage because you had godly parents who led you in the way of the Lord. But even amongst us, including myself, some of us are first-generation Christians. First-generation Christians, that's, identify yourself now. My father was Muslim. My mother was an Anglican. And so her sisters used to refer to the children, us, as Omo Imale. But thank God, Omo Imale can now come in the pulpits and preach the word of God. We thank God. So even if you're a first-generation Christian, you know that the line can start with you. You can be the Lois of your own times, and you will now have people coming after you that will show forth the light of God. The advantage of this godly line is that, you know, you can tell me, morning devotions, good morning, Jesus. Yes, morning devotions, you went to the camp, quiet time, night vigils. I'm sure you were sleeping most of the time, but you still went by force, by fire. But you see, it's good, but it's not the end, because God does not have grandchildren. Every child has to be led to have a personal relationship and a walk with God. So, I mean, we see the example in the Bible. Eli, his children did not follow after the Lord. Even Samuel, surprisingly enough, after what he'd been through, his children too did not follow the path of the Lord. But it is an advantage to at least have that example. So the next text is 2 Timothy. It now addresses Timothy again, chapter 3, verses 14 to 15. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it, and how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. So you have that, you know, like when you're having a race, you give some people a gap. You have that gap, that you have that, you know, start, a good start, but continue. Make sure that you are grounded in Christ himself, each person. You know, those children, when I saw them, the song that I thought of was Atike Kere Moshe Uluwa. Yes, from young, you have been bringing them to the house of the Lord, but they have to have a relationship, and they have to now walk in his light and walk in his ways. Now, how did Jesus show that he loved us? Because we're talking about love now. How did Jesus show that he loved us? He died for us. His only crime was what? His only crime was loving us. That was his only crime. Now, we're talking about mothers today. How do mothers show that they love us? Does anybody want to share how her mother showed that she loved her? Have you eaten? Good. By beating you. So I will give you two examples. Yes. Has anybody heard of Ash Good? Ash Good. That's the name of the lady. You haven't heard of her. Now, just this last month, April, there was a mass stabbing in Sydney, Australia. You heard about that? Okay, so you know who she is. She was the mother who protected her child. The child still got stabbed, but at least she protected the child. The last thing she did was hand over the child to the people that could save the child. And she died trying to save her child. She died from her injuries. And that's the way a mother's love is. And then, of course, that's why they say, have you eaten? So you will not die. Have you eaten? And then the person that says that they cane you to show that they love you. Do you people cane your children? Now, I don't know whether, I'm sure you know Brother Deji Olubi. It was in Teens Church he gave this testimony that when he was like a teenager, he was very rascally. And his mother said, this child cannot spoil on my watch. So she took him to the police station, I think Adekunle police station. He said, if now when he passes that place, he still remembers. And said, this child, he wants to be lost. Okay, let him come to you. And the policeman cooperated, dealt with him. Look at all these people. There are people that didn't listen to their mothers, and they are now behind bars. He said, after he got home very late that night, the second day he went on hunger strike. The mother didn't send. Third day, hunger. When he realized that he was punishing himself, he now resets his brain, and he thanks God. He still thanks God till today for what the mother did. Because the people he used to go around with, they didn't become anything. But his life was changed because of the mother's tough love. So we thank God for our mothers. Now, we have talked about mother's love, but I want to include all of us. So how do we show our own love, evidence of our love? Somebody said, there must be lawyers in our midst. Oh, really? So if you were arrested for being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you? So I need two volunteers. Please give them a microphone. Not lawyers, sincere people. No, lawyers can be sincere too. No. That wasn't a dig at you. I want people. No, I want people who will say it as it is. Eh? And I also need NIV, an NIV Bible. NIV, who has NIV? Oh, they put on the screen, NIV. Okay, two people. They can come and sit. Okay, please, can you move to one? Can you? No, so they can sit together. They can sit here. Yeah, the two people who will tell it as it is. Who can say things with their full chest, eh? Okay. Okay, can I have 1 Corinthians 13 from verse 4? NIV version. On the screen. Okay. Now, it says love is patient. Okay, but I don't want you to say love is patient because we said we have a legacy of love. So you have inherited love from the Father above. Mm-hmm. So instead of saying love, sorry, what's your name?
Yemi.
And your name, madam?
Bisuyi.
Yemi is patient. If you can say it sincerely that you are patient. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
I'm not patient.
Please. Thanks for your sincerity. My sister?
No.
Okay, before we even look for patient people, because love is patient. Why are you not patient? Yes.
I get exasperated when I'm explaining something to somebody and he's not getting it.
Okay.
I think it looks similar. I just feel you should be fast. I'm always fast. Everything I do is fast.
Okay. So, is that, how are you expressing your love to the person that you're not patient with because they're not fast enough by your standards?
Surely, I'll just keep quiet, but inwardly, I'm like, should be sharp now.
Okay, thank you. But we have a God who is patient with us. Are we fast all the time?
No.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Is anybody here patient? Let's see.
My wife is patient.
Where's your wife? Is her name Patience or she's patient?
She's patient.
Where are you? Okay. Please. No. Come. We need you. Yes, you can take this. Oh, okay, they give you a microphone. So, why are you patient? No, it's a very good... We have to learn from her. Why are you patient?
I think I'll attribute that to... It's a temperament. Then I'll attribute it to the God factor. Because... Many times you cannot achieve anything by not being patient.
The fruit of the Spirit is patience or long suffering, even longer than ahead. So our sister is fruitful. Okay, you are not off the hook yet. Yes, the next one, love is after patience. Okay, so can you say with your full chest?
I'm very kind.
Okay. I am kind.
Okay. So why are you kind?
I feel everybody should be happy. I feel people should be happy. That's why I'm kind. I'm willing to extend happiness far beyond marriage.
Okay. Why are you kind?
Okay. I learned kindness from my mother. She always tells us that you must be kind to people. But when I came to know the Lord, I'm from a Muslim background, yes. When I came to know the Lord and I found it in the scriptures, I prayed that I will be kind in the way God wants me to be kind. So that's what happened to me.
Are there people who are struggling with being kind? Now, that's why I said I want sincerity. Are there people who are struggling with being kind? Can you express why you withhold kindness? Everybody is very kind here. You know, we learn more. Thank you. We learn more from people who show their vulnerability.
Sometimes when the kindness has been abused, so you tend to be a little bit weary about showing it, even if you have the temperament or the endearment to be kind.
You run out of steam. You have been burnt too often, especially in Nigeria. Yes, somebody else wants to say something.
So sometimes as a boss or a manager at work, you be kind. There are some people that, I don't want to say they just have coconut head. No matter how you try
this to... This passage,
cajole,
you're making me go ahead of where we're going about our language. Oh, love is not rude. Coconut head. Continue.
No matter how...
Ondeshe meshe.
No matter how you try to cajole and teach... And, you know, be kind and show love, really. They choose not to do the right thing. And if you keep being soft and kind, it would affect your job. So at some point, you have to be strict and, you know, you really have to be firm and give out punishments, really.
Yeah, but God is kind, yet he gives judgment. Yes, justice... does not mean that you're not kind. In fact, sometimes it's kind to give out judge punishment because they will change. Maybe we talked about our brother Olubi. That's what changed his life. I'm sure he thought his mother was very unkind when she took him to the police station. So what you're saying is valid. Okay, let us continue. I have Bible references, but I think... Okay, I'll just give you the references. We'll check it later so I can... You are giving word, even as I'm taking the comments. And then love. Kindness is caring for one another. We can be generous. Because as Matthew 10:8, that's a reference. Freely we have received. Freely we have received. We can freely give. Because the people that we look at and we look down upon and say, these people, I mean, there are some people, now if they enter the bus and sit beside you, you will get up. True? Yes. Did they have your opportunity? Did they? You see, when you're in the ghost land, you see those children, those Malam children running around. I don't even know where they sleep. So really, let them touch our hearts. And then let us even start praying about, maybe I'm the one going to solve this problem. You are young people. You are solutions people. Praise the Lord. Okay, the next one, we have kind. The next one. We're still on 1 Corinthians 13. We have used our names to say kind, patient. What's the next one? But we're not saying the word love. You've already inherited love. So say your name with your full chest. Uh-huh.
Misui does not envy.
And you stand on it.
Yes, ma. Uh-huh.
Yemi does not envy.
And you stand on it.
I stand on it.
Okay. Why do you not envy? And the people that, we're going to look for people that envy and they will say, why you? And then also, oh, yes, my sister, yes?
Okay, so I don't envy because I believe my life is not empty. So if I believe if your life is empty, that is why you should.
Let me paint some scenarios for you before we all go spirit here now. You have been applying for work since the person that you helped to fill his application form, applied and got a job. And you are still as you were. How will you feel? Oh, yes, go ahead.
Yeah, there are times I feel very bad. And I mean, it happened to me, you know, people who have literally helped and followed tips that I've shared and they get jobs and I've been on the job in the job market like for a long time. But I think one thing I've learned that I'm still learning is that Because before, I envy people. Like, I'm very envious before. But, yes, I'm a very... Before, I just feel... Not like I hate them, but I just feel, why is this good thing happening to this person? And it's not happening to me, right? Despite the work that I've put in. But then, it now happened to be that God opened my eyes to see that instead of being envious of this person, God is actually calling me to help them, to pray for them, to intercede for them.
You have spied on my notes. Go on.
That is how I've been able to... So if I feel bad and envious, I just pray for the person and my heart is just so soft and everything.
For me, I have this, what we call, temptation to envy. That, because I know as a Christian, I'm not supposed to envy. When it comes, I kind of suppress it and rather pray for the person, or, you know, it's something that I worked on, and it doesn't have a hold on me because I worked on it.
Yeah, the flesh is struggling with the spirit, and the spirit is winning.
Yes.
So, in little things, I won't say I envy, but there are times when you have like waited for something for a long time, and then everybody now seems to be going ahead. Two things that God has helped me with is first realizing that I can tell God how I feel. I can say, God, how far now? But I felt like we were going to get this thing. And secondly, I realized that if my friend has it, he's in my neighborhood. That's something that helps me. I've seen it as a sign that it's going to happen for me too.
Yes. Any other tips? Oh, somebody, okay.
I think life also has helped me. I mean, I'm in the midst of a lot of friends, colleagues with clear opulence. You see it all around, either in terms of the kind of vehicles they drive or the houses they built. And some you are even senior and you wonder where they got all these things to, I mean, that they show. But over time, life has, I mean, made me to realize that, look, just like a brother of mine told me once, he said, look, you see now, you don't know how their end will be like. So that has helped for me to, it has dissipated in terms of it being envious. I just focus more on God, how will God help me to sort my own self out. Thank you.
Yes, one more. The lady in yellow, gold.
All right. For me, I really don't envy because I think I've been in practical situations like that. I believe whatever you have, you can't have mine. It's yours. So mine would surely come. I'm a child of God. Every father promises his child. So mine would definitely come. I've been in a situation whereby I had people under me that was going for an examination. And it was looking as if it was my job. And the person came to me and said, the address. I still taught the person everything the person needed to do because I feel if God is telling you to take my place, then God is preparing me for something greater. And so that's just it.
Yes, she has... You have something to say. Please go ahead.
I also want to attribute it to home bringing. Because when we were small, we must not take another person's thing. Even if they're giving us, my mother's eyes is on you. And, you know, once you see the eyes, you just conform. So, you know, so she was teaching us to be content with what we have.
Contentment. Contentment. Because, and then also, we should count our blessings. Oshore forba, osheti joye, no. He did good for the king and also for the subjects. God is big enough to bless all of us. All of us. And, you know, you said it, that your own blessing, in fact, it's going to be more. Because the longer you wait, it's incubating. Yeah. You know, elephants take longer in the womb than grasshoppers. Okay, grasshoppers don't have wombs. Yeah, the next one. Oh, yeah, I'm listening. Put your name. Don't wait for them to put their name. Put your own name. Mm-hmm.
Yemi is not boastful.
Okay. With your full chest.
But I'm very proud.
You're boasting that you're not boastful. Yes, my sister Bisoye, yes.
I am not boastful. Because I believe that there is nothing that I have that is not received from the Lord.
Yeah.
So I didn't add anything to it, so why should I boast? Okay. And I have heard a mentor of mine that says to us that before you begin to boast, ask yourself, are you the first person in that field? Are you the first person to ever have that? Then you'll be able to learn to close your mouth.
Okay, I'll give you a Bible text. Proverbs, okay. For the envy one, Proverbs 15, 17. Then love does not boast. Proverbs 27, 2. And 2 Corinthians 10, 17. Why do you think people boast? Because everybody is saying they don't boast, they don't boast. Why do people boast? No boastful person here. Yes, yes.
Okay, so I would not say I boast, but sometimes you feel like you're putting the effort, right? So yes, you're not the first person, but I put in the effort, so let me own it. That I'm just saying, like...
I love this, your Gen Z language. Let me own it.
So just, for example, someone finishes the first class, you can't tell me not to boast. Like, I'm just like being honest, right? Like, I did the work. Let me glory in it. At least for now, I may say, oh no, let me, but for now, let me glory in it. Yeah.
Praise the Lord.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. I think people boast many a times because there's this void they try to fill. It's a thing to be proud of yourself, but when it's time for you to start rubbing it in people's faces, showing it, you know, telling everybody that cares to listen, more or less like, you know, there's this gratification, something that you're expecting to actually see as a result of what you've done, but it's actually not coming your way, but then you feel, okay, it's important that I put it out there. Being boastful, being proud is very good to me, but being boastful is actually just way out of it. There's no point being boastful.
Ah, we're going to reach love is not proud though. So,
being proud of myself, you know, for accomplishing something, yes. But you know, being boastful, rubbing it in other people's faces, it's not just.
And then also, I think it depends on your culture. You know, the Americans, if they don't boast, they're not happy. They're not happy. But the point is, we have that saying, empty vessels or empty barrels, they mock the most, yes. So let people acknowledge what you're doing. Let them even hail you themselves, you know. Let me see, Proverbs 27:2, I think, can you put it up quickly? Proverbs 27:2, what does it say? Yes, you have a microphone. Somebody has a microphone. Read it.
Let someone else praise you and not your own mouth, and answer that and not your own lips.
The patient, our dear patient sister, I'm sure you can wait, because sometimes if you're waiting for them to praise you, it will not come. But the Bible is telling us in the other thing about the other reference is 2 Corinthians 10, 17. Let him who boasts... Yes. That is it. Let him boast in the Lord. Because the truth of the matter is, you might be very brilliant, maybe very prepared for an exam. And then you go there, you may have a blank brain. Hasn't that happened before to some people you've heard about? So it's God that keeps your brain sharp. Yes, it's God that keeps your brain sharp. And, you know, we should be able to give him the glory. So even if we're going to trumpet our, you know, whatever we're doing, let us use it to boast about what God is doing in our lives. Let it be a testimony. You know, there's some people that are like that in church. Anytime they say they should come and give testimony, they're always out there. Yes. Maybe that's what you should be doing. Come out and be testifying. Next one. I don't want to hear the word love. You've already inherited that love. Oh, yeah. Bisoye is not
proud.
Yemi
you can
proud.
Say that.
Yeah. Yemi is proud.
Okay, so very good. Why are you proud? Why are you not proud?
I feel I'm a special creature. I feel I'm different from every other person. I believe I'm a genius. So
whatever I do, I try to show it, not show off as it were, but try to impact my environment. So I'm not very quiet about my achievements. It speaks for itself, and I carry it anywhere I go.
But the lady sitting next to you said that let other people praise you.
See, the truth is that we need to come to context in the kind of country we are in. You keep quiet, no, but nothing would speak for you. Everybody is ready to run you over and the rest of them. So you need to showcase, like for my own background, I work in the bank and for many years, and it's very competitive. And if you we are the people that go on suspension for booking bad loans, and would you see the same people that get promoted? Because you see us, if your accounts are very good and they are very small and they're very quiet, nobody sees you. But when your accounts are big and you book billions and it goes bad, you go and fight, you get recovered. So I've learned, I've learned to be very, very vocal. I've learned to be very, very, to be achievement driven. So that's why I'm a bit proud.
What do you have that you have not been given? What you're saying makes sense. But you see, the Lord who wrote this Bible, he knows Nigeria now. I mean, he doesn't know that Nigeria is a tough environment.
Yeah.
Somebody wants to help me out.
A friend of mine is a lecturer, doctor, PhD, University of Ilorin. So, but he's very tight, very smallish man. And he goes about just as simple as himself, in shirt and trousers. So he went to an office in Abuja, and he was offering a Christian literature to a man who needed it. So the man just looked and then just pushed him off. Then he kept quiet and said, "I'm Dr. Latunji." Immediately he said, "I'm Dr. Latunji." The man sat up and said, "Let me have the book," and started attending to him. So I don't know, will that be that he is proud? Because I also had an incident. I went to Queen's College I kept going. The principal would not see me. So one day I now put my title. She came out. Immediately she got it. She came out and welcomed me into her office.
Thank you for your examples. Now, that takes us to Ecclesiastes. There's a time for everything under the sun. There's a time to speak out. There's a time to be silent. And it's the Holy Spirit that will lead us to distinguish and discern the times.
Thank you, ma.
Okay. Shall we continue? Uh-huh. Yes, Sister Bisoye. No, we're not. We've gone on to the next one. Love. Auntie Bisoye is not
the son of others.
No, I want NIV version, so it'll be easy.
Yes, it's NIV, ma. Does not.
Okay. Okay. No, there's love is not rude.
Love is not rude.
Oh, this is an improved NIV. Okay. No, but it's fine. They mean the same thing. Does not dishonor others is not rude. Good. So, you don't say Dundee. Uh-huh.
No, I'm not rude.
You're not rude.
I'm not rude.
You're not rude. Now, those people who are rude, own it with your chest now. You are. Please give her a microphone. I need to find, to understand why she thinks she needs to be rude.
So, I like that. But anyways, I feel like when it comes to being rude, one of the reasons why I tend to be rude most of the time is because people come at me first. So, for example, I'm inside the bus and I'm speaking calmly, like, conductor, please, can I have my change and stuff like that.
She's being honest, though.
So,
go
I'm
on.
Like, conductor, can I have my change and all of that? Maybe because I'm speaking English. He was like, Alaye, I'll give you a change. Okay, let's let the Spirit of God work. Okay, calmness. I I'm almost at the bus stop. Conductor, please, can I have my change? Ah, Alaye, I'll give you a change. Ah. Conductor, Alaye, can I have my change? Yeah, I'm ready. I'm going to change my job. So, in situations like that, it's because they always come first. Like, they always want to wear this camouflage. Because I'm like, oh yeah, Alaye, I'm going to change my global shell. Okay, now my change is outside. So, I feel like in situations like that, if I didn't react in their tone or the language that they understand, they wouldn't, I don't know, they would not give me my change and stuff.
Okay. Very good. Thank you. Thank you. I love her honesty. And the truth of the matter is she's not the only one. But the Bible says, yes, yeah, quotes. And then also, the bottom line is that love never fails. What she is implying is that when you are being gentle and kind, that they will not answer you. You will not get your change. Now, the question is, are you ready to leave your change so you can be true to God's word? I'm going to go back to my sister Bisoye. Yes. What would you do in that situation?
I was just telling her that whenever I enter the bus, first I always look to for change. But if I do not have change, as I'm entering, I'm saying, Joe, I don't have change, Joe. I'm always begging them. I don't get involved in their.
You see, we have a problem. We think that yes, go ahead.
People who are not diplomatic are regarded as being rude most times. Is a question I'm putting to you.
But you know rude now, Maya will reform. That's what she told you now. You know rude. Diplomatic can just be blunt. But there are some that is out, it's offensive now. And in fact, there was a story about two people that, you know, jammed each other in the traffic. And they both abused each other very well. And then it was a Sunday morning, they were rushing. And they ended up in the same four square car park. Uh-huh. And you think God is applauding them? No. We have to, you see, that's why we're talking this morning. You see the wisdom. I know I'm not ready to Yawiri Laroi. So, I will have my change. You have to pay the price to be what God has called you to be. Yes, there's somebody at the back. I'd like to hear his voice.
Praise the Lord. All right. I had a scenario that happened in my office. And it's a daily occurrence in my office then. So, my colleague used to tell me, I had an issue with my direct boss. So it has been going on for years. You know, being a Christian, you try to be calm, you try to relate.
Doesn't know what the dairy is.
You know, you try to relate and, you know.
Like a dunce or something. Dunce. Yeah.
So the lady who was my colleague always tell me to sing, you need a lot of smart up. Maybe you can't take it for granted. And obviously she is. She was. So I'm useful to her. She's my boss. I'm useful to her, but she makes me look that I'm useless. You know, somehow it was affecting my job. So there was a day I got to office late. You know, I called, she wasn't picking up. So I called that lady, who's one of my colleagues, and I explained to her that I'll be running late. So I had to take bike. Several days I take bike to office on the express. So as soon as I got to office, he said, you know, I tried to play with that. And you're like, what is saying any query? Not respond, but I said, multi-boss, but I'm sorry that I came late. All for me to get to my table, check my system. She has copied the same. I said, you know, I couldn't hold it anymore. So I told her, I said, Kuku soft me pe o fe kin be sise. That was how I changed it for her. I forgot. Yes. I forgot that we had customers in the banking hall. I forgot I was a Christian at that moment. It's something that has been often, you know. So that day, she had it. She saw the other side of me. And one thing about me is once I get angry, I start stammering and, you know, I can't control it. That. So funny enough, we had an auditor who was in the banking hall as well, who also tried as much as possible to calm me down. So after the whole thing, we were supposed to go for a party. So my colleague said, Ejeki Tosin will represent to her. She said, no. Bawo ni Tosin ma lo, she represent. Tosin ba lo ta lo ma sise. So I was like, so the lady now says, so Bobo is useful for the man rubbish here. So to me, I don't know if what I did was right, but it changed a lot of things for me.
Thank you for sharing. Doctor,
God way to change things just this time. I said, I don't doubt that things would have changed after that, but there's a God way to change things. It just takes longer. But there's a God way to change things like that.
Yes, but sometimes, there's a time to speak your mind. There is. It's just that we should be sensitive to know what God is saying. And it brought out what she never accepted, that you are very useful to her. So that is the way the world is. They use you and dump you. But we're going to show a better way. A better way that you value people and you talk nicely to them. You'll be surprised. The Bible says a soft answer turneth away wrath. Try it. Okay, let's move on. What's the next one? We're almost there.
I'm not self-seeking.
Yes, Brother Yemi?
I'm not self-seeking.
No, I'm not.
Now, why are people self-seeking?
Okay, for me, I feel the reason why is because it just feels like sometimes if you don't look out for yourself, nobody will look out for you, if you are being honest. So, like, I don't know if that's what self-seeking is, like, trying to...
He watches over you. My singers, every sparrow.
Every dress is the lady.
Yes, sing it. You even sang it before, yes.
Ivy dresses the lilies
with so much
beauty and splendor.
How much more
will he clothe you?
If he watches over
every sparrow, how much more does he love you? How much more does he love you?
We sing it passionately. The test is when you go out into the marketplace to see whether you really believe it. Because if you say God is watching over Sparrow, you're much more now than Sparrow. Yeah. He will watch over you. Yeah. He will fight your battles. Yeah. Yes.
I'd like to testify that you're right. When I was working in the bank, that year, I was working in the company secretary's office, and we are the one that closes at 11 o'clock. There are just three of us in that department.
11 p.m.
You be a yaba, the head office. So you cannot even come down. When my husband comes to pick me, the gate is quickly opened and quickly closed because of the area boys. So when it was time for promotion, our head called us, the three of us, and said, the personnel lady was there, and said, Mrs. Somebody, these three people, they are not going to be promoted this year. I don't care when last they were promoted. But this year, they are not going to be promoted. And they didn't do enough, this, that. She said it. And the three of us left. And we're all believers. In fact, I didn't even think about it. Lo and behold, when the promotion list came out, my name was written in caps, all caps. While the other ones were written in lower cases, you know, or, you know, initial, you know, like that. So, and it was not only me, all the three of us. So,
all the three of, you, all the three of us.
And she even called personnel and said, why? I said this. I was not in the board meeting where they decided who to be promoted. Our name did not go to the board because she had to come up, you know, she's AGM now and she is junior to her. She had to come up with the list she sent. And we were the ones who collated for the board. So, you know, we didn't know because the work was too much for you to start searching. But truly, his eyes is on the sparrows. So he will do it when he wants to do it.
We should not just sing it with passion. We should live it with passion. The verse is Philippians 2, 3, and 4. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should look not only, they didn't say you shouldn't look to your interest, not only to your own interest, but also to the interest of others. Love as you are loved. God, I see you now. God is loving you. I've seen, where you people, I saw you as teenagers. I've seen you grow up. And I know God is keeping a good eye on you. And he wants to showcase you to the world. But don't use the world's methods. Because that's the temptation. Yahweh Refue. That is. Okay, the next one. Time is. Brother Yemi. Your wife is sitting very near you.
I'm easily angered, but I keep record of the wrong, but I don't get angry about. See, I need to explain that part. I'm easily angered, I don't show it. I keep record of wrong, but I don't show it. But not that I feel bad. If you have wronged me, I just give allowance. It's your prerogative. You've just expressed. I just let it go. Mm-hmm. But I know that you've wronged me. Mm-hmm. So, but I don't feel bad about it. I don't keep malice. I don't have anybody in this world that I think is my enemy.
You forgive them.
I forgive them for well away. But I know you have wronged me. So I'm always careful. The next time I'm dealing with you, that you don't take advantage of me. Okay. So I keep record of the wrong, but not for that I'm angry with you or I don't forgive you. I've forgiven you, but I have record in my head.
Okay, but what if this person that you are avoiding, you are the one that will lead that person to Christ?
No, I'm not avoiding the person. I will relate with you.
You relate.
We'll laugh. But maybe when it comes to very sensitive things. I'm just careful. This guy could hurt me again, so I'm really a bit careful.
Okay, but you forgive.
For well.
Okay, we take your word for it. Yes. Can you give him the microphone? We'll come to you.
So easily angered me, not exactly, but keeping record of wrongs. Yes, I do, and the reason is because. Same thing, especially if same thing keep happening and we have not discussed this. I'm the kind of person that if I am offended or I offend someone, I try as much as possible. At that time, let's talk about it. And that's it. But then several times because of the person's temperament or the kind of person the person is or situations, some things might not be discussed and it will just be there. So it could take a while. I would have forgotten it. And if it happens again, and then I then remember that, okay, so time, this person did so thing. And I then say it. And my wife, in a very gentle service, say, MC, love does not keep record of wrongs. But why do you say the thing, they happen all the time? You understand? So that's the thing. That's the thing about me.
Now, before, sister, we really are running out of time. Before we take Sister Bisoye, the question is, the things you do to God. Hey, if we were to keep a record of our wrongs, who will stand? My concordance wants to talk.
Well, you know, the brain, you can't erase things. You know, people do things to you. You know, you can't erase them. But what shows that you don't keep a record of wrongs, it doesn't affect the way you relate to them. So if you have an opportunity to do something good to them, you don't say because they did, yeah, then if you say that, then you are keeping a record of wrongs.
A bad record.
So if whatever they do to you does not affect the way you relate to them, then you don't keep a record of wrongs. Even though the record may still be in your brain, and there's nothing you can do about
R-O-M?
That.
This is called random access, R-A-M. Yes.
I don't get easily angered. And it's not for any reason other than I don't like trouble. So I run away, from trouble. When it's going to become an argument, I just leave it.
You let it go. Now, the last one. Oh, yeah, read, Brother Yemi. Love, Brother Yemi does not.
I never give up.
Love does not rejoice in evil. Yes, that's it.
Okay. I don't rejoice in evil. I rejoice with the truth.
Okay. But you know, what if somebody has done something bad to you and then something bad happens to them?
No.
I want us to be honest too.
No.
You don't say, God, don't catch him.
No.
Okay. Praise the Lord.
We're making
progress. Then the last one. The last one. Yes.
Love, it always protects. I always protect. I always trust. I always hope. I always persevere. I don't give up.
Okay. Okay, somebody wanted to speak from there. Yes. Oh, our camera lady. Yes.
So it was relating to the rejoicing in other people's sorrow. Misfortune, sorry. Me personally, if you offend me or something bad happens to you, I'll be happy. Because it's just the way it's supposed to work. Like, no, hear me out, okay? Hear what I want to say. What goes around comes around. What you sow is what you reap. So if you do me strong thing and somebody else does you strong thing, that's your business, that's your fault. But the truth of the matter is that if you do something wrong, definitely someone else is going to do the same thing or even worse to you. That's just the way it works. So if I see you that something has gone bad for you, definitely I'm going to be happy. I'm sorry.
Please, I need a pastor to answer her. A pastor in the marketplace.
As a pastor in a house. So Ara, the truth is that if you feel happy when something bad happens to that person, then you negate the whole essence of this our faith. Okay. Or you feel justified. Yeah. See, that is, if you look at, Bible says, for God's, God does not want the death of a sinner. And he wants everybody to repent. God is not happy when we pass through challenging times. So, the same way, if somebody has to pass through a challenging time, you can't be happy and a person is suffering. It's not, even apart from faith, morality. Yeah, it doesn't, morality does not even allow it for you to be satisfied if somebody is passing through a challenging time, despite the fact that he has wronged you. How much more faith? Because the Holy Spirit in you.
Finish. Yeah,
the Holy Spirit in you would not be happy because you are happy and somebody is feeling bad.
Before Dr. Onozo gives us his words of wisdom, I want to say that part of the problem is the songs that we sing. There's this song, I Get Back in O, very popular. So Is that what the Bible says? So we have to know our Bible, or otherwise we'll be swayed. Dr. Nuzo.
Okay. I think it's a natural thing that if somebody does something bad to you and God retaliates for you, you know, it's a natural thing to say serves you right. Yes. I mean, it's like a woman says to her husband, that gele that we are going to use for the wedding, let me buy. Say, that's no money, that's no money. And then he's passing and his leg hits the table. God is speaking to you direct. Uh-huh. So it's a natural thing. And the only way to stop yourself from doing it is to pray, Lord, please, you know, save that person. The Bible says, do not be overcome with evil. But you don't stop there. You have to overcome the evil with good. Otherwise, it will stick. Yeah, that's why every time you see yourself trying to do something that is wrong, find something that is right to counter it with. That's the only way to continue to grow spiritually.
Thank you for your honesty. You've answered all of our questions. Yes. Now, so Romans 12, let us just, when we get home, read Romans 12. It will show us the Christian position, not any toba juju, kimia, or whatever they sing. Now, God gave his only son as a substitute for us, so he could have a world of little Jesuses. He wants each one of us to look like Jesus. He wants the downfolk boy, when you are getting down, to see Jesus in you. He wants the market woman that's trying to cheat you to see Jesus in you. He wants that your mean boss to see Jesus in you. So, he has moved. Now, I'm sure everybody, if I say Romans 8:28, you will all go through it. But I'm not going to do 28. I'm doing Romans 8:29 to 32. And I'm going to read it from the Message Bible. We're going to end at this point. I'll read it from the Message Bible. God knew what he was doing from the very beginning. He decided from the outset to shape the lives of those who love him along the same lines as the life of his son. The son stands first in the line of humanity he restored. We see the original and intended shape of our lives there in him. After God made that decision of what his children should be like, he followed it up by calling people by name. After he called them by name, he set them on a solid basis with himself. And then after getting them established, he stayed with them to the end, gloriously completing what he had begun. You see, it's a journey. We might not be there, but we should seek to get there, not feeling that the methods of the world is what works. As our sister said, God's methods may seem long, but it's worth proving that his word is true. Now, this is like God's purpose. This is what God wants, to create little Jesuses from everybody sitting on these chairs here. Now, I know I have many bankers, financiers here. You know return on investments. Uh-huh. He invested so much to make each one of us like Jesus. Is he getting a return in my life? Is he getting a return in your life? That's the question. That is why God sent his... The mother's here. Even if you have 10 children, can you give up one? Not to talk of his only son, who committed no sin, no offense. So the legacy of love. Well, this is Mother's Day. This is the type of parenting we should be giving our children. I know you will, if I ask you to tell me stories, you'll be telling me how your parents, you know, were not fair to you. I'm sure your children too in their time will say how you were not fair to them. It goes round. But it's all because of love. You know, you want them to turn out right, I understand. But the legacy of love, the God type of love, we have gone through it. It wasn't for, in fact, this preparing for this helped me because I kept saying, why? Why am I not patient? Because I'm not patient. It's because, you know, you think you must have that thing now. You may miss it if you don't have it now. It's not true. It's not true. And then to be patient with others, that's the example that she gave. You know, God says you should love the way you would want somebody to be patient with you. That's the way you should be patient with your brother, with your sister, with the downfall conductor. That's a tall order, but that's what he asks of you. And he knows that you are able, you can have it in you. So, is there anybody here who, because this legacy of love, this God type of love, is not possible without Jesus. It's impossible. Even with Jesus, he had. Not to talk of without Jesus. So if you are here and you want to give your life to Jesus and have a relationship with him, please let us indicate by raising up your hand. He's still accepting friends. He's still saving. He's still delivering. He knows what we're going through. Is there anybody who wants to give his or her life to Christ? Okay. It's a congregation of believers. But the believers are on a journey. Some of us are nearer our destination than where we should be than others. Remember, I said, he gave all of us, every one of us here, he gave us light. Let your light be bright. If there are things that are keeping your light from being bright, we talk about resistance. The conduction is not the way it should be. We have seen the standards, and he has given us his Holy Spirit. Let us yield more to the Spirit and not give occasion to the flesh. So at this point, I think we can just bow our heads and say a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you. We bless your name because you know exactly where each one of us is at. And even though you know exactly where we are, you love us passionately, and you are committed to taking us to where you would have us be, if only we will yield to you. So this morning, I yield myself to you. I ask that the legacy of love that you have put in my life, and that you have put in the life of each sister and brother here, that that legacy will blossom. Because, Lord, if we are living the way we should be living, Nigeria cannot stay the same. Our homes cannot stay the same. Husband and wife will not, they will show love to one another. Parents will show love to their children. Boss and employee, wherever we are, whoever we will meet with the love of Christ. Thank you, Father, because you can do this in us. And you are able to do far more than we can ever hope or imagine because of the grace that lies within us. So, Father, Lord, we pray that our lives daily might be transformed so that we may be more and more like your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.